Thank you, Jonathan. Can I start with a round of applause? This guy has the toughest job today, so thank you, Jonathan. It's truly a high honor for me to be back here in Herzliya in Israel and to address this august audience. Before I begin, Boaz, where are you? The lights are bright. Boaz, we met a long time ago in Germany in a program created by an amazing guy called Colonel Nick Pratt. I'd like everybody who's new to this event to understand what Boaz has created here. I have become convinced, especially after my stint inside the White House, that the real strategic answers to the threats we face together as America, as Israel, as members of the Judeo-Christian civilization, the best answers are actually found outside of government by people who nurtured them, such as Dr. Boaz Gnor. There is a massive, sometimes impenetrable inertia that you found and find in bureaucracies that kills creative thought and sees policy as business as usual. I have seen the belly of the beast from the inside. Take my word for it. Before I begin properly, so thank you, Boaz, for what you do. Thank you for ICT. Thank you for IDC. I don't think I've given this many interviews in my life as I've given today. You have an amazing team. Thank you. I was introduced as a Brit. I know I have a funny accent, but I'm an American, and I'm a proud American. As the first American keynote, if you'd indulge me, Boaz, Jonathan, may I ask all of us to stand for a moment of silence for the events of 16 years ago. Thank you. On a personal note, I'm going to talk to you about what changed in American counterterrorism policy at 12:01 on January the 20th in the United States. Before I begin, just a personal touch. I thought, being the child of people who lived under fascist dictatorship, with parents who were persecuted under communist dictatorship, with a father who was tortured and arrested by members of the secret police, I thought I had an adequately cynical understanding of the world. I was very naive. The last 7 months of working in the White House has showed me just how bad it is. But what's the good news? I resigned 2 weeks ago, and I vowed that I will support the president and his agenda from the outside, and that's what I told the president. But I'd like to take this moment to note, there's an American saying, when the going gets tough, the tough get going. I'd like to make an addendum, you know, for all you academics, is footnote number one. When the going gets tough, that's when you find out who your real friends are. I'd like to say thank you to all my real friends, Boaz Gnor included, who have stuck by the truth in the last 7 months and have not been afraid to support that truth. Thank you. So, September the 11th. September the 11th is the largest terrorist attack of the modern age. It was the catalyst for more than one military operation that followed, Afghanistan, Iraq, and also the catalyst for the largest reorganization of the American national security enterprise since the National Security Act of 1947, which created not only the CIA, but the National Security Council. In the last 16 years, thousands of American men and women have died wearing the uniform of the United States military. And trillions, literally trillions of dollars have been spent on fighting and prosecuting that war. So I have three very simple questions to posit and to try and answer today. Are we winning the war, which is the longest war America has been engaged in since 1776? If we haven't won it yet, can we win? And lastly, what will it take to win? On one very simple metric, the question to are we winning is answered by many very simply as, oh yes, of course we're winning. Why? Because in the last 16 years we have not had a mass casualty event on the soil of the United States equivalent to the death that occurred in just 102 minutes in New York, Washington, and Pennsylvania 16 years ago today. The largest attack we've had is the Orlando massacre, in which only, quote unquote, only 49 innocent people were killed in one night. 3,000 down to 49. So does this mean we're winning? Well, I would say this is a very myopic, a very short-sighted conclusion. Why? Because mass casualty is not the objective today of groups like ISIS. They've reverted to different tactics. They've brought irregular warfare to the streets of Europe, to the streets of America. They brought tactics that Israel is far too familiar with. The knife intifada did not start in Europe. The knife intifada started here. The use of vehicles as weapons is not a recent invention that Europe has suffered. It is an age-old weapon that Israel is intimately, unfortunately, familiar with. Likewise, they've changed their tactics because they've moved from bringing foreign jihadists to our soil to recruiting, indoctrinating, and sanctioning residents to execute attacks, such as the San Bernardino killers and such as the Boston bombers. I don't like the phrase homegrown terrorism, but let's use it for a second. There's a big problem with homegrown terrorists. They don't apply for visas. As a result, they are much, much harder to locate. If we move beyond the myopic and short-sighted and we have a less parochial filter to answer the question of whether we are winning, then the picture is not so rosy. The bottom line is, jihadism as a global phenomena is increasing. We have seen more plots intercepted on US soil in the last 3 years than in any comparable period in the prior 16 years. The frequency of plots has greatly increased. And more disturbing than that, the rise of Islamism writ large is a global phenomena. From Arab states to non-Arab states to European communities, politicized extreme versions of Islam are more popular, not less popular, and this creates a permissive environment. Don't get me wrong, I've been accused of many things, especially in the last 7 months, but I am not, and I have never said, that we are at war with Islam. Anybody who says there is one version of Islam is an idiot. There is no monolithic Islam. Get on a plane from Indonesia and fly to Saudi Arabia. You will see two very different versions of Islam. Go clubbing in a disco in Amman, and then get on a plane and fly to Pakistan. Two very different versions of Islam. The trouble is, the wrong versions of Islam are becoming more popular, and the more modern versions, such as we see in Jordan, such as we see in Egypt, are being systematically undermined. This is not good for Muslims, and it's not good for all humans. So, how do we explain the fact that the world's most powerful nation seems to be losing this war? Because America isn't just a superpower. I like what François Eisbourg says about America. He created a new category. America is not a superpower, America is a hyperpower. We are the most powerful nation the world has ever seen, bar none. 12 nuclear aircraft carriers. America has more special operations forces, just special operations, guys. We have more than many countries have soldiers. That's a metric of power. So why aren't we winning? I've identified two key issues with why we have not won this war in the 16th year. Number one is that the last three administrations, the Bush White House, the Obama White House, and the current Trump administration, are linked. This may shock you, but they are linked. The link is an unnaturally buoyant emphasis on the kinetic aspects of counterterrorism, meaning the physical, the violent, the military. It is no exaggeration to say that if we have identified, if our intelligence community has identified a high-value target anywhere in the world, if the Secretary of Defense or the President gives the green light, we will find you and we will kill you. We are that good. Nobody comes close. Israel, not bad. Not bad. My old friends, the Brits, pretty good, but not the same level. But so what? What does this mean? Because we can kill, I mean, don't get me wrong, I have nothing against killing terrorists. I'm very down with killing terrorists. But using body bags as a metric of victory was a bad idea during Vietnam and is not a much smarter idea today. Why? We have an adversary that when you kill them, you kill one high-value target on Tuesday. By Friday, you'll have 50 people who have volunteered in that locale to replace that terrorist. At least 50. It is an endless cycle of violence. What is the larger part of the equation? We must stop people wanting to become terrorists. It's not just about killing or arresting them. We must de-incentivize people, men and women, from wanting to choose that lifestyle. So in the last 16 years, we've invaded other people's countries. Under President Bush, under President Obama, we've droned people. You know, the president sat in the White House with his iPad, looking at the threat disposition matrix and choosing which jihadi we're going to kill today. And today, under the Trump administration, we have gone from a strategy of attrition. Under Secretary Mattis, we have moved to a strategy of annihilation. When the president says, "I will obliterate ISIS," he's talking about physical obliteration, which is all well and good, but we need more than that. I'm not a big fan of neoconservatives, but Donald Rumsfeld was right. You remember his infamous snowflakes? He wrote these short memos to his senior management in the Defense Department. His most famous snowflakes asked the very simple question of his deputies: are we killing more of them than we are creating? That's a question as valid today on September the 11th, 2017, as it was 16 years ago. So, what's my conclusion to that? We have to go beyond what we have done for the last 16 years, which is to pay lip service to the war of ideas. We must engage vigorously and robustly in the overt and covert domain in undermining the ideology of the enemy. Because the enemy we face today is not a new enemy in its classic sense, because there is a connection between the fascists and Nazis of World War II and the communists of the Cold War and the jihadis we face today. What's the connection? They're all totalitarians. You cannot negotiate with Hitler, and you cannot negotiate with Abu Bakr al-Baghdadi. They will enslave you or they will kill you. What we have to make sure is that the minimum number of people want to support them. So I hope, I know the people who are writing it furiously right now. I helped when I was inside the building. Right now the administration is getting close to finishing its new national security strategy. And very soon we'll be releasing its national counterterrorism strategy. As an American taxpayer, as a man who wants to win this war, I want to see a very robust counter-propaganda element to both of those documents, because that is how we will win. The second issue is a more operational one. That's grand strategy. Let's look at a more operational issue. Sun Tzu was right. Clausewitz was right. Always identify the center of gravity of your enemy, because that's your real target. What's the center of gravity of jihadi cells today? It's not the individuals. When you focus on the individuals, what you're doing is, as we say in America, you're mowing the grass. Yes? Because you can whack one terrorist and then another one will pop up. That's called whack-a-mole. It is not a very strategic approach. It is far more effective to identify the individuals who never pull a trigger, who never detonate a suicide vest, but who have 40,000 or 200,000 followers on Twitter. It's much more effective to follow and neutralize the ideologue who is telling other people to pick up the gun, who is telling other people how to turn a pressure cooker into an improvised explosive device. Because you neutralize that one person, and you've neutralized thousands of people, or stopped the recruitment and the indoctrination of thousands. Now, this is a challenge, because our nation was founded on the principles of the First Amendment and on freedom of conscience and religion. But we must find that balance. It is no longer satisfactory for YouTube to say, we're not going to take that jihadi ideologue's video down, we're just going to put it behind a screen that says sensitive. No, because that video has one purpose, to kill you and your children and your friends and your colleagues. So we have to work on tools to neutralize or redirect those ideological products. Lastly, as I mentioned before, we have to have a broader strategic understanding. The great irony I tell my colleagues, and I told diplomats visiting, I told anybody who cared to listen to me, America is the most powerful nation the world has ever seen, but at the same time, it is the most astrategic. We haven't thought or acted strategically since about 1988. Okay? Why? Because we're so powerful. We don't have to be smart. As Ed Luttwak, one of the few people alive today who deserves the title of strategist, once told me, what is the point of being a superpower if you can't be stupid? Right? When you've got 12 aircraft carriers, you can make a lot of mistakes and just, clean it up afterwards. When you're Israel, you make one strategic mistake, and it's goodnight Vienna. Right? So our power is also, in one way, our weakness. But we have to go back to the beginning and ask, what is the real threat to America? We focused for 16 years on the Sunni jihadists. Understandably so, because it was Sunni jihadists from Saudi Arabia and Egypt that flew those planes into those buildings. It was Sunni jihadists that executed the Fort Hood attack, the Boston bombing, San Bernardino, on and on and on. But we will deal with them. We will crush them with our friends and allies at our side. But I have become convinced that there's a bigger problem than Sunni jihadis. And unfortunately, there's a nation that understands the bigger problem and has been trying to tell us since about 1979, and that's Israel. Shia jihadism is probably a bigger problem. Why? Because it's a nation state that is still the greatest sponsor of global terrorism. It is a nation state that is a functioning theocracy. It is a nation state that has perfected the art of indirect warfare through the use of proxies, such as Hezbollah, such as the Quds Force. And it is a nation state that, thanks in part to the last administration of President Obama, may acquire nuclear weapons in the not too distant future. That is why the JCPOA is a, to quote my old boss, a bad deal. Because it didn't stop Iranian acquisition of nuclear weapons, it mildly delayed their acquisition of nuclear weapons. To quote a certain prime minister who goes by the nickname of Bibi, the prime minister of Israel said in front of Congress one sentence that was perfection in terms of strategic analysis. He told us, we weren't really listening, if you want to understand the Dantean inferno that is the Middle East after the Arab Spring, which should more correctly be called the Christian winter. He said, if you want to understand the disaster that is the Middle East and North Africa after those events that we call the Arab Spring, all you need to do is to understand that it is a game of thrones for the crown of the caliphate. He's got good speechwriters, hasn't he? Game of Thrones, it's good. Why? Because we have two visions of a future theocratic caliphate. We have the amateurs, Al-Qaeda, ISIS, the non-state actors, who wish to see a Sunni-run caliphate, and had one until Mosul was recently liberated. But there's another version that the mullahs want to create. And if you look at the last 5 years, at what they've achieved in Iraq, in Syria, in Yemen, it's not good news. So we need to learn from our Israeli friends. We have to understand that Israel is and was right about the threat from the Iranian Republic. But let me, after, they say, I've got Hungarian blood in my veins. They say I'm really good at depressing people. That's a Hungarian thing. Let me leave on a high note. Most people really misunderstand my boss, really misunderstand my old boss. They listen to the fake news, what a colleague of mine called the fake news industrial complex, and they just don't do due diligence about who this man really is and what he believes. And let me give you a little secret about who Donald J. Trump is. He's not an ideological leader. There's no easy ideological label you can slap on his forehead, because he doesn't think in terms of ideological cliches. He is a patriot, and he is a pragmatist above all else. As a result of his pragmatism, think about it, this is a guy who wasn't just successful in the hardest market in the world, New York real estate, he became a billionaire in the hardest market in the world. As a result of that innate pragmatism, he is in the best position to jettison the subjective blinders, the subjective filters that in the past have determined our response to the deadliest terror attack in modern history. He is clear-sighted, and he understands that America must and will win its longest war. America, your best friend, changed a great deal on January the 20th, especially in our response to counterterrorism. We have restored relations with your great country. To quote a very good friend of mine, a warrior in the world of ideas, I steal this from him. Jeff, if you're watching, I'm sorry. Israel is the greatest nation God ever made. America is the greatest nation man ever made. There's a kind of partnership there, kind of partnership. And let me reassure you, the US Army has a motto. We are one team. America and Israel are founding members of the Judeo-Christian civilization, and together we will defeat our common enemies. God bless and thank you.